with news recently that we may be getting something new, finally, in the Jurassic World Evolution universe. Either a sequel or a Camp Cretaceous E750 tie-in DLC is my bet. I thought we'd spend today building a wish list of how to make Evolution 2 the best sequel it could possibly be, all the while trying to keep things, you know, moderately realistic. Moderately. What's life without a little optimism? Other than my current life, XD. If you have any ideas of your own, let me know in the comments down below, but here's my personal top 10 in no particular order, other than the one my fingers decided to make, basically. Let's get started. Number 1, more customization. Now this is pretty much the most obvious choice going, but one of the big problems with Evolution is simply that you can't actually decorate your park or your exhibits, really. Now this has become better over the time with the addition of new trees and rocks and signs, etc. But the game is still sorely lacking in this area. Now I'm not expecting Planet Zoo levels of customization, but basic things like benches and street signs and building colour options and maybe different logos and stuff, more plants and trees and rock variety for exhibits, some fun things, you know, like placeable skeletons and skulls and holograms and anything that gives our parks just a little bit more personality. A little bit of va-va-voom, a little bit of bada-bing, a little bit of, you know, you get the picture. Number 2, full integration of aquatic and flying creatures. The Pteranodon was a big step forward, and it showed that Frontier can implement flying creatures in a way that's, you know, absolutely appropriate for Evolution, and really no different than how any other game is doing it. These creatures are fundamentally part of Jurassic Park lore at this point, and it would be a shame to not see them inbuilt as a feature into the next game in the series. That means aviaries of different sizes and aquatic pools of different sizes, maybe with a little customization there in terms of lighting, environments, and colouring, but even that would not strictly be necessary. Just give us some variety in the creatures we can populate them with, and I think people will be pretty happy. Would it be better for them to be real AI creatures and not on animation loops? Sure, but that is a very tricky thing to do, especially with flying creatures. And I think most of us would be okay with good extended looped animations as long as we had actual creature variety. It's very silly that Evolution doesn't have a Mosasaurus, it just is. I know that's incredibly harsh language, but it's silly, I'm not afraid to say it. Number 3, in-species variation. Now this is something Planet Zoo has implemented more over time, and I'd like to see it brought over into Evolution. What I mean by this variation is that you could breed two identical animals genetically, but one may come out a little darker than the other, or a little taller, or a little bit more vividly patterned. These don't have to be drastic changes, you know, 10% either way would be fine. Just enough so that when you've got a huge herd of dinosaurs, they don't all look the same size, shape, colour. Every dinosaur is a special little snowflake and it should be treated as such. Number 4, guest mode. The fact that, I'm gonna get angry, the fact that I have to bring this up in 2021 is very stupid, but given it's still not really implemented even into Planet Zoo, I know we had Tejidcam, but is Tejidcam even official? Is it part of the literature of the game? I have no idea. It seems I need to bring it up. As a general message to anyone on the planet, really, anyone thinking about building a zoo or park game of any form, put in a guest cam. That was in caps in the script. So is that. It cannot possibly be that difficult to implement. It doesn't even have to be good, it could just literally be a set level camera that moves at a certain speed. That would be enough. And yet games keep not doing it. One of the great pleasures of zoo games is being able to wander around and experience your creations as your guests do. Now this is doubly true in dinosaur games, where a lot of their impact is brought about because of their sheer size. You want to feel like a teeny tiny person who could be eaten alive at any moment of disaster, right? It's not just me, right? I don't need a therapist, right? Number 5, the basic gameplay loop. Now this is probably the hardest one to fix, and I do understand why it is as it is, but let me explain. In Evolution, your main gameplay consists of sending out dig teams, analysing fossils, building enclosures, and filling them with dinosaurs. You'll build other buildings, start research, occasionally quell a breakout, but those first three things are basically your constant gameplay. And the problem is, it's not that exciting. Fossil digging is time limited like a mobile game, and exhibit building wears thin because of that lack of customization we mentioned earlier. There's two main things Planet Zoo does differently to escape this problem. The first is staff management, a part of the game that is entirely missing from Jurassic World Evolution. and the second is of course the vastly increased customization, which keeps most of us busy for like 90% of the playtime. Evo absolutely needs a way to make this basic loop more exciting, whether that's increased control at dig sites, you know, you could choose particular regions within the dig sites or send specialized teams out and, you know, train your teams up and stuff like that. Maybe you could get more involved in fossil extraction or more interesting unlocks as you unlock higher dinosaur percentages, stuff like that. Maybe Mr. DNA pops up and tells me what a good job I'm doing and I feel less dead inside. Either way, we just need a little bit more something to do. Number 6. Breakouts. And this kind of ties in with number 5. The security and breakout system needs an overhaul, and that's a good chance to make the basic gameplay more interesting. Having a Gallimimus whomp its head against solid concrete for half an hour until it bashes through is very, very weird, and probably pretty painful. Rather than concussed Gallimimus, maybe we actually have to think about what fences we use, that'd be fun. You could keep the same 3-tier system we have, which is steel, strong steel, and concrete for example, and just have certain dinosaurs unable to break out of certain tiers. A Gallimimus should never be escaping really from anything, probably. Maybe a Stegosaurus needs a tier 2 to be contained and a Triceratops needs a tier 3. You could keep the electrified fence system we have. At the moment it just makes fences tougher, it doesn't actually do anything, it doesn't repel them properly. You could keep that system and use it as a way of preventing dinosaurs from climbing out or from touching the fences at all until the power goes out and suddenly you've got much more to worry about. You know, I think that would make power cuts very impactful if your raptors, which are 100% contained because they can't climb the electrified fence, of course, suddenly they're climbing their way off the exhibit because the power's gone out. That would be very exciting. The bigger aggressive carnivores, your rexes and such, retain the ability to break out of basically everything. They should always be a threat, and there you go, easy, done. Suddenly it's more interesting, power cuts feel more impactful, and of course a tornado or sabotage or something could absolutely carve through your park, open up all the fences and lead to a breakout. Basically I think breakouts need to be rarer, but also inevitable, and to feel much more deadly and scary when they do happen. They need to be higher impact. Number 7, security. Following on from that, because it seems I have a lot to say on this topic, the security system is just a little bit dull. The teetering balance between chaos and majesty is for me one of the most prominent themes of Jurassic Park. And when that chaos hits, it needs to hit hard. Jurassic World, oddly enough, has one of the more effective dinosaur breakout scenes in the entire franchise, and that's when the Indominus is taking out the security team and we see their life signals blank out one by one. Assuming we can get a slight increase to staff management systems in Evo 2, why not implement something similar? How much more impactful would that Indominus Rex breakout feel if it ate your favourite? You've had the security guard, you've trained him up from the start, and he gets eaten alive by an Indominus Rex. Billy Bob was one day away from retirement and you just watched him get eaten alive. That would be so much more impactful, it really would. I think sending off your security teams and being able to track their progress via monitors and life signs would be immensely exciting and not as tricky to implement as it actually sounds. But hell, if not this, then just something else, something to put the fear of dinosaurs back into us, to make us worry about our guests and our staff members. Breakouts aren't a nuisance, which they are now, they should be, you know, the end of the world, basically. Number 8, island customization. Now this is something we've cried out for since day one, basically, so let's see it in Jurassic World Evolution 2 from the ground up. For what it's worth, I do think Evolution's islands are much more interesting than the weird square we got on JPOG, but absolutely all of them having annoying mountain ridges or bizarre shapes does limit our creativity. All we really need is one singular map that's just a wide open field, or a weird square island if you want to keep that surrounded by mountains. Give us the absolute maximum amount of room possible according to memory limitations, and let us do what we want. Theming and realism is important, I'll give you that, but player agency and choice doubly more so. We don't want limits, we want to do as much as we can be possibly allowed. If you want to push that further with randomized islands, you know, mountains, rivers, beaches, JPOG essentially, that would be even better. But even just a semblance of what JPOG gave us 20 years ago combined with the current islands would be a huge step forward. With more and more time as I age, basically, I get more and more annoyed by artificial limits on player agency that's put into video games. You know, like scenes where the game forces you to walk through because it's dramatic, stuff like that. You know, if I want to walk through and savor the moment, I'll do it. You don't need to force me to do it. This is essentially the same thing. I'm going to complain about this for the rest of my life now, so you best just get used to it. Number 9, mod support. I know, controversial. Console players, I can hear you reaching for the pitchforks and the torches. But by mod support, I don't mean built-in mod capabilities, however. I simply mean an open acceptance that they're going to happen. I'm immensely thankful to Frontier, and shout out to Bo, who's actually moved on to another company now, but shout out all the same, with how they allowed me to begin covering mods and maintain our working relationship. But it being such a messy process in the first place felt a little bit unnecessary. The entire reason Evolution is still played as much as it is now is because of mod support. That's got to be accepted fact at this point in time. The mod community keeps the game alive, keeps hype and support for Evolution 2 alive, and it's what has kept Evolution on the map despite no updates in nearly a year and a half. I understand fears on how modding would make a dent in DLC sales, for example, but I think those are pretty unfounded. If we look at games like Skyrim, ones with huge and vibrant modding communities, do the mods halt DLC sales? No, not at all. Even dinosaur packs provide us with this via new skeletons and rigs to work off. The other concern, of course, is that, and I think this might be the major one, is that if mods break the game, which happens, some crazy stuff has been done lately, that Frontier would be the ones dealing with the fallout, and they don't want to, and that's understandable, that's very understandable. And that's why I'm not asking for much. Just a clear message to the content creators and community from the very start: mod the game, feel free to showcase the game, mods, etc, but we have nothing to do with it, and put like a disclaimer in. Easy peasy, that's all it takes. I just want that slightly more open communication and acceptance on the topic right from the get-go. We're going through it again with Planet Zoo right now. Number 10, and final on the list then, the campaign. Of course, by the time I got to writing this one, I suddenly had 20 more ideas, but the campaign feels like an important one to address. Fundamentally, every campaign level in Evolution is the same. It may take place on a bigger or smaller island, you may get thrown a few fancy dinosaurs and have a little bit less cash, but the way you tackle every island is identical. It's no wonder the game has basically no replayability in the campaign. Maybe it does for a few of you, but personally, it didn't for me. One of these problems is the sheer insanity of some of the missions and how annoying they are, and a lot of it can be attributed to those same basic gameplay loops we talked about before, but I do think some basal campaign variety is urgently needed. I really appreciate we got to explore all of the 5 deaths, a very cool thing, no doubt, but there's just no variation in objectives. The DLCs did address this, to be fair. Woo, to a lesser extent, Claire's much more than the others, and Return to Jurassic Park all had missions or objectives that involved, say, clever usage of dinosaurs to contain or kill other dinosaurs, or they lacked missions with park building entirely in the case of the first mission in Claire's, or they introduced time limits. These are positive steps, and not all of them were successful. That disease-curing mission in Claire's is so mind-numbingly boring, I cannot believe it got past testing. But it at least showed a willingness to push the boundaries on what these missions could be. Time limits might be stressful for a few people, I totally get that, but one or two of them being well implemented is a way to keep campaigns fresh and moving forward. We don't need to build big, sprawling parks in every campaign mission. We do that enough, we have sandbox modes for that. What I'd love to see is a campaign with twice as many missions, but many smaller ones with varied objectives. Maybe a park where you can only build carnivores, or a park where security is offline so every dinosaur needs to be taken out one-on-one. One with no park at all. You know, put us in a ranger vehicle, tell us to get to such and such location, and put a ton of rabid carnivores in the way. The gameplay loop is already there. The gameplay for that mission exists in the game. It wouldn't be hard to implement. Now, some of these are just bad ideas, I'm sure. But the point is to give us something other than, here is island. Island is weird shape. Build park, make millions of pounds, because there's another problem wherein money's really hard to make at the start, and then eventually you're just rolling in it and it never becomes a problem ever again, and then move on to the next weirdly shaped island. Variety is the spice of life, and it's also the spice of park builders, as it happens. Anyway, that's my 10. This could have been expanded further, but I do find things like breeding, for example, to be unrealistic, and I know it happens, and it was, of course, a fairly big plotline back in Jurassic Park, but it's never felt like the main focus going forward. It's worth mentioning that I do think evolution, even modless evolution, assuming you have all the DLCs, has become a much, much better game than it ever was in the past. It's come on leaps and bounds. I only gave it a 6 out of 10 at release, which always confused me. Some people always told me I was like a stan for the game and that I refused to criticise it. I gave it a 6 out of 10, I don't know, people confuse me. But I do think I would bump that to an 8 to an 8.5 now. There's room for improvement for sure, but the game has become a lot better. I can see the potential for it to be something truly special. And right now it's not. It's a good game, and modding's maybe made it even a little bit better, maybe even a great game. But it's not quite the masterpiece. It's not quite that game of a generation. It's not quite that park builder I think we'll be playing in 20 years. You know, it's not hit that level yet. And I really hope we see Frontier push it and try to hit that, if we do indeed get a sequel. Of course, this will all be pointless when it turns out what we're actually getting is E750 DLC in a couple of months, but hey, that would be pretty cool as well. It'd be nice to know that we can get some official extra content for Jurassic World Evolution, I suppose. Either way, it's fun to speculate. If you enjoyed this video and you want to be a super cool person, or even if you don't want to be a super cool person, this applies to both of you somehow, throw me a like down below. That'd be very super cool, or not very super cool. And let me know what you think as well. You know, is there anything on this list that I missed? Try to, you know, be as realistic as you want, basically. Do you want breeding and baby dinosaurs? I would love that. That would be fantastic. I just think the chances of baby dinosaurs is very, very low, personally. Either way, I'll see you lovely folks next time. Cheers, much love as always. Bye-bye. Reaching out.